Well, there are 3 days left till November the 3rd, 2020, when general election in the United States should take place. We will be electing our president, vice president, some governors, representatives, and on city level, on county level, on state level, there is a lot of names to process, and many will be making decision. Many have already made a decision and have mailed their ballots. So it is in this context that we have started a short 3-sermon series called Jesus Christ and Politics. And the first sermon was titled Jesus Christ, comma, a Republican, question mark. The second was Jesus Christ, comma, a Democrat. And today, sermon number 3 has the title Jesus Christ, a Politician, question mark. We will try to answer this main question. If Jesus lived today, would he become a politician? Would he run for president of this country or any other country where he would happen to reside? That's the main question for today. So let's start. The first passage in the Bible that we could take a look at connected to this topic is in the book of Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verses 30 through 33. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." We find immediately that Jesus was born to be king, and he has a throne waiting for him. His kingdom will last forever and ever. His kingdom will never end. So by definition, a king obviously is a politician, correct or not? So this is the first statement before Jesus was born. Now let's go to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 2, verses 1 through 3 and verse 16. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. We see immediately that Herod the king, he perceived the news about Jesus' birth as a threat, as a political threat, because he immediately perceived Jesus to be a political rival, and he made sure of the following. Let's read verse 16, the same second chapter. Then Herod, when he saw that he had been tricked by the wise men, became furious, and he sent and killed all the male children in Bethlehem and in all that region who were 2 years old or under, according to the time that he had ascertained from the wise men. Herod saw Jesus as a king who could threaten his rule. Now, fast forward couple of decades, Jesus has turned 30 and he began his public ministry. And we read about the following. The Gospel of John, chapter 6, verses 14 and 15. When the people saw the sign that he had done, they said, "This is indeed the prophet who is to come into the world." Perceiving that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, Jesus withdrew again to the mountain by himself. It's a very curious passage. So first of all, we read that Jesus had learned that this group of people was about to use what? Do you see it? To use force to make him a king. Why would they use force on Jesus? What does it mean? What is the underlining, what is the assumption behind this statement? What do you think? They knew that he would not agree voluntarily. They knew that they would have to make it sudden and apply force to make him a king. And as soon as Jesus learned about this plot, he immediately withdrew. He disappeared. He hid. Right? It says that he withdrew again to the mountain. So he hid in the mountains by himself. Jesus refused to become a politician. Is it clear from this passage? He did not want to become a king. He refused that role. Later, though, we read in the Gospel of John, chapter 12, verses 12 through 15, the next day the large crowd that had come to the feast heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him, crying out, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel." And Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, just as it is written, "Fear not, daughter of Zion. Behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt." So this time, would you say he is accepting or refusing to be a king? He is not protesting anymore. He is not hiding. He is not opposing. He is accepting. And the reason is given. When they say that he is the king of Israel, then there is a quote. It says, "just as it is written." And the quotation is from the book of Zechariah. Let's take a peek. Chapter number 9, verses 9 and 10. This is the prophecy that's quoted in the passage that we just read. "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Righteous and having salvation is he, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the war horse from Jerusalem, and the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall speak peace to the nations. His rule shall be from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth." What kind of a king is pictured here? Did you catch the description? First of all, it says it's a righteous king. It's a king who brings salvation, and by his character, he is a humble person. He's sitting and riding on a donkey. And then other animals are mentioned here. Did you catch which ones? Horses. It says that when he would come, he'll do the following: "I will cut off the chariot and war horse from Jerusalem." So, talking in modern terms, what will this king do? He will destroy all the weapons. He will destroy all ammunition, all military devices, killing machines, and so forth. And then later it says, the battle bow shall be cut off. So this is a kind of king that is very unlike any other kings. Typically, they would ride on a horse, on a battle horse. They want to use force. They want to use military force. They want to use their might in terms of weapons and arms and so forth to get victory over their enemies, establish their governing power, and so forth. But this king, he wants peace. You see, his rule shall be from sea to sea, and it says that he shall speak peace to the nations. This is the kind of king Jesus was. He wasn't a political figure. He didn't want to overthrow the Roman government. He was a king of righteousness. He is humble. He is the one that's not like any other kings that have existed throughout the history. And then later, we read in the book of John, the Gospel of John, chapter 18, verses 33 through 37, the following. So Pilate entered his headquarters again and called Jesus and said to him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me?" Pilate answered, "Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have delivered you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting that I might not be delivered over to the Jews, but my kingdom is not from this world." Then Pilate said to him, "So are you a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice." Jesus finally spells it out. I am a king, yes, but my kingdom is not earthly one. If that was the case, he had enough supporters to fight for him, as many of the false messiahs did at that time of the earth's history. Jesus says, this is the nature of my kingdom. My kingdom is not earthly. I am a king from heaven. My kingdom is spiritual. And then the last passage about this that we will read is the book of Matthew, chapter 25, verses 31 through 34. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on his glorious throne. Before him will be gathered all the nations, and he will separate people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will place the sheep on the right, on his right, and the goats on the left. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world." Jesus will become a king here on this planet, but only when he comes back. At his second coming, he will come in glory. He will sit on his throne, and he will invite those who have been with him to inherit the kingdom of heaven. So, this is when and how Jesus will become a king. All the prophecies about Messiah being a king will be fulfilled, but not in this political context, political rivalry. His kingdom is heavenly. His kingdom is spiritual, and it will once come. So, back to our main question. If Jesus Christ lived today, would he become a politician? What's your verdict based on the passages that we read? No, never. He refused many times. He is not a politician, and he will not become one had he lived today. So we are done with the main subject and the main goal of this message. But what shall we do on November 3rd? Right? How does it help to vote, the way that would honor God, honor his law and his commandments and his will? The first portion of my message today was titled Jesus and Politics. The second portion that starts today and right now is called Christians and Politics. What did Jesus have to say about his followers being involved with politics? Are you curious? Thank you for nodding your head. You are in masks, so I'm not able to read your facial expressions, you know, as precisely as I could have. But your eyes are telling a little bit. So let's do it. What about Christ's followers? Let's go first to the book of Hebrews, chapter 13, verses 11 through 14. For the bodies of those animals whose blood is brought into the holy places by the high priest as a sacrifice for sin are burned outside the camp. So Jesus also suffered outside the gate in order to sanctify the people through his own blood. Therefore, let us go to him outside the camp and bear his reproach, the reproach he endured. For we have no lasting city, but we seek the city that is to come. This is the first statement that answers our question. We don't have any lasting cities here on this planet. But we are waiting for a city, for the city, which is to come. A little bit in more details, Philippians chapter 3, verse 20. But our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Very concise and clear statement. You might be a citizen of United States of America, Russia, Ukraine, Australia, you name it. But if you are a follower of Jesus Christ, your real identity, your true citizenship is in heaven. Let me read it again. It says, our citizenship is in heaven. And the word citizenship, interestingly enough, in the original, in the Greek language, is politeuma, where politics and politicians come from. These words come from Greek. So our politeuma, our politics are connected to the heavenly kingdom. We are citizens there. Therefore, what shall we do while waiting to enter, to get naturalized there? The words of Jesus, Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 and 10. It says, pray then like this, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. The phrase that I would like to concentrate your attention is your kingdom come. Let your kingdom come. That's the prayer that Jesus asked us to pray. What does it mean for the kingdom to come? Let me share with you a couple of passages from a well-known Russian scientist whose work was in aviation, in among other things. His name is Igor Sikorsky, Igor Ivanovich Sikorsky. He has a book that is a commentary on the Lord's Prayer, on this prayer that we just quoted. And this is what he writes. In order to come, it is necessary that the object A is not yet in the considered place, B exists in another place from which the arrival is expected. Basic logic. Again, for something to come or for someone to come, it logically necessitates that that something or someone already exists in other place and is expected to transfer his presence to another, right? The next paragraph. These two conclusions are mandatory, logical consequences of the correct use of the word come, which in this case is beyond doubt. If we accept that the kingdom in question does not yet exist, it would be more correct to say your kingdom may be created or instituted, but not come. If, on the other hand, the kingdom of God is perceived as already existing on earth, it would be logical to ask for its continuation or victorious expansion. But we pray for the kingdom to specifically come from heaven to the earth. And that is our reality. In the book of Daniel, chapter 2, verse 44, it says, "And in the days of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that shall never be destroyed, nor shall the kingdom be left to another people. It shall break in pieces all these kingdoms and bring them to an end, and it shall stand forever." So the kingdom of God, when it will come, it will destroy all the kingdoms already in existence. United States of America will be destroyed. Russia will be destroyed. Britain will be destroyed. All the current kingdoms and those that might, you know, get created in the future by the time Jesus Christ, all of them will be crushed, will be destroyed. And then and only then the kingdom of God will be brought here, will come here. You might remember that stone in the vision of King Nebuchadnezzar that struck the statue down, it flew from somewhere else and it crushed and destroyed everything to tiny pieces. This is the kingdom of God. That kingdom doesn't exist on the earth, but it is real. And it is in existence in heaven, from where we expect Jesus Christ to appear very, very soon. So please do not ever deceive yourself that there is a Christian country somewhere on the planet, that there is a country, regardless of the claims. You know, one nation has accepted Christianity in the year 301 AD. Another nation has accepted Christianity as the state religion in the year 988 AD, and so forth. Regardless of the claims, there is no kingdom, no state on earth that satisfies God's will and never will, because all these kingdoms will be crushed. They will be destroyed. So what it means is that the hope of creating heavenly kingdom, God's kingdom, in the context of any state, in the context of any country, is not a viable idea. It will never happen. It will never happen. And the sad reality of history teaches us vice versa. Any time that a Christian religion would want to become the ruling party and create a Christian state, anytime that has happened in history, and there is a number of examples, anytime persecution, bloodshed, and death of millions of people resulted. Millions of people have been killed by Inquisition, by the church during medieval ages. So any time that there is a dissent, any time that the state church thinks that someone is a heretic or doesn't worship God the right way or doesn't understand or accept church policies and so forth, if that state church has power, it will act to crush and to kill and to persecute all others. That's the reality. So when we know that Christ is not a politician. He was not and would not and will not be a politician on earth. But he is a real king of the real kingdom, a heavenly one that is coming to this planet. When we are waiting for that to happen, we should realize and don't deceive ourselves that no state on earth satisfies God's will and never will. So what shall we do? What shall we do? There is a well-known phrase in the teaching of Jesus, which is found in the book of Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 22, verses 15 through 21. Then the Pharisees went and plotted how to entangle him in his words. And they sent their disciples to him along with the Herodians, saying. So there are two parties. What's the name of the first one? Pharisees. The second one? Herodians. Who are they? To understand the significance of this passage, we need to know at least a little bit. So here you have it. Herodians first, according to Brockhaus Bible Encyclopedia. The Herodians were a political group, a party of Roman supporters among the Jewish nobility. So this is pro-Rome. Herod is the king. So his interests, his rulership, and everything else, so the interests of Roman rulership is Herodians. Now, what about Pharisees? A lot could be said about them, but specifically in the context of their political views, who were they? Brockhaus Bible Encyclopedia again. Pharisees, a Jewish religious and political party, which, unlike the Sadducees, were not significantly influenced by Hellenistic and rationalist ideas. Pharisees were pro-nationals. You know, Jews should govern themselves, this type of thinking. So they were against Rome. They were looking to overthrow Rome. And that's why the question that was asked. So knowing this political setup, let's continue reading. Pharisees and Herodians joined their forces to catch Jesus. And they said, "Teacher, we know that you are true and teach the way of God truthfully. And you do not care about anyone's opinion, for you are not swayed by appearances. Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why put me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. And Jesus said to them, "Whose likeness and inscription is this?" They said, "Caesar's." Then he said to them, "Therefore, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's." The predicament that they put Christ into was the following. If he says, "Yes, pay taxes to the Caesar," he would immediately be or become an object of revolt on the part of Pharisees who were nationalists. If he says, "No, don't pay taxes to the Caesar," immediately the other party, the Herodians, would then find something to accuse him of. But Jesus gave a brilliant answer. "If it is Caesar's coin, you are doing nothing but returning what's already his to him. But God has ownership as well. In fact, he has primary and prior ownership. So return to God anything that is his." This answer is called a dichotomy, which means that this is true and this is also true. So we live in a dual world. It's physical, and there are Caesars, there are rulers, there are presidents, governors, and so forth. But at the same time, God is still the ruler over all. So there is this material reality and there is this spiritual reality. And Jesus' answer says basically the following. You have dual citizenship. fulfill the requirements of both. Your duty to God, to his kingdom, and your duty to Caesar, to the country that you reside in. The measure of loyalty to Caesar, of course, is limited to the loyalty to God. So when we have established that the hopes of creating a Christian nation is not real, when we acknowledge that Christ wants us to be good citizens of his kingdom and the kingdom that we reside in. Now, specifically, how do we choose the ruler? How do we choose a person, a politician who wants to become this or that? The Bible has something to say about that as well. Let's go to the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 17, verses 14 and 15. When you come to the land that the Lord your God is giving you, and you possess it and dwell in it, and then say, I will set a king over me, like all the nations that are among me, you may indeed set a king over you, whom the Lord your God will choose. One from among your brothers you shall set as king over you. You may not put a foreigner over you who is not your brother. First of all, let's define the pronouns. It says, verse 14, when you come to the land, what does this you mean? Who does it describe? When you come to the land, verse 14. The nation, right? The people. So here we have the nation of Israel and all foreigners that decided to follow God and entered into the covenant with him. They are entering a new land, right? And God says, when you come to the land, and then you say, I will set a king over me, you may indeed set a king. So who chooses the king? Who sets the king according to this law? The people are. Do you see it? Twice it says that you set the king. So the nation is involved. The people are there. This is their choice to make. But that's only on one hand. Because when you continue reading, it says, verse 15, you may indeed set a king over you, whom the Lord your God will choose. This is the duality that we were talking about, the dichotomy. Spiritual and earthly. So, yes, it is people who are voting, people who are putting someone into office, right? But if you are a citizen of heaven, you will put a person whom God chooses. Meaning that the person should be the one that God would choose. And how to do that? God gives us the following instruction. Let's continue reading. The same chapter, Deuteronomy 17, verses 16 through 20. Only he must not acquire many horses for himself. What is the requirement? What do horses mean? We already know. Military. Chariots and horses were bought in Egypt by those nations that wanted to grow their military might. And the Bible says, the king that you would choose, that you would set, the one that God would choose, he is not to do that. He would not grow the military might. Why? Why? Because God says, I will fight for you. I'll send hornets. I will send hail. You stay and watch the salvation that I provide. That's the ideal. So when you will be choosing a president or any other politician, this is one of the questions to ask. The Bible says, he must not acquire many horses. Then it says, verse 17, and he shall not acquire many wives for himself. Isn't it curious? He shall not acquire many wives because itself, lest his heart turn away, get spoiled. And then it says, nor shall he acquire for himself excessive silver or gold. Another point to look at. Now let's go on reading verse 18. And when he sits on the throne of his kingdom, he shall write for himself in a book a copy of the law approved by the Levitical priests, and it shall be with him, and he shall read it all the days of his life, that he may learn to fear the Lord his God by keeping all the words of this law and the statutes and doing them, that his heart may not be lifted up above his brothers. Let me pause. So we are choosing the person who, first of all, accepts God's laws, the book of the law, which is the Pentateuch, first five books of the Bible, otherwise known as Torah. The person accepts, and then he tries to live accordingly. So we look at the person's life, at his moral values, at his dealings, or her dealings, or whatever. But we look at how does the person square with God's moral standards. And then another thing is, it says that his heart may not be lifted up above his brothers. So this is not an arrogant person. This is a humble person, a true servant. And then the Bible continues, and that he may not turn aside from the commandments, either to the right hand or to the left, so that he may continue long in his kingdom, he and his children in Israel. So the continuation of his reign is conditioned upon how faithfully the person follows God's law. That's the measure of whether we should keep him or her in office or vote him or her out of the office. That's the moral dilemma. Unfortunately, throughout the history, this model has not always been at work. For example, this is my last passage, the book of Hosea, chapter 8, verse 4 says, they made kings, but not through me. They set up princes, but I knew it not. With their silver and gold, they made idols for their own destruction. So, whenever someone thinks that God is the one who puts the kings in place, that's not the case. Sometimes, yes, God does work in history. He does put some people into places of authority, and he takes them down. But this doesn't mean that whoever is a king, it is God's will for that person to be in the office. The Bible clearly says, they made kings, but not through me. So today we are finishing up the short series titled Jesus Christ and the Politics. Jesus is not a politician because none of the political structures on this planet are according to God's will. But he is a king of heavenly kingdom that will be soon coming and be established here. And while we are waiting, our choice should always be based on biblical principles, clearly outlined for those who are becoming rulers. May God bless you in making these important decisions so that it brings as much good as possible on this wretched, sinful planet. Amen.